you can look at the river two ways. Hudson Valley represents the aesthetics, how beautiful America was, transcendental ideas of finding God in nature. There's also a dark side. The dark side of the Hudson River Valley is in the river. It's in the sediments of the river.
Sailing down my dirty stream, still I love it, and I'll keep the dream that someday, though maybe not this year, my Hudson River will once again run clear, 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 clear.
New York is known for a lot of things. Skyscrapers, nightlife, traffic. But wildlife was not one of those things. Until now.
I'm Celia Ackerman. I'm an onboard naturalist on the American Princess Whale Watch boat.
I know I've seen this whale before.
And I'm also a research associate for Gotham Whale.
Organizations such as Gotham Whale have been monitoring the increase of marine mammal species in the New York waterways over the past decade, a phenomenon Celia could have only ever dreamed of.
Having marine mammals in our local environment, you know, they weren't here when I was growing up. And one thing I remember as a youngster that I couldn't wait until I got old enough to move out of New York so that I could go live somewhere where I could be close to whales and dolphins and seals in the wild. Prior, I mean, everything in the early 1900s, the ocean was basically a garbage dump.
Ever since industrialization began on the riverbanks of New York, the Hudson River served as the primary dumping ground for sewage, industrial chemicals, fertilizers, and trash, leaving the river to be a toxic, lifeless waste pool.
Most of the pollution took place from 1940s to 1970. And we were seeing by 1960 globs of just sewer and floating down the river. You can just take a sediment of the river and identify the pollutants layer by layer, and it tells you something about the whole history of the Hudson River Valley. From when farmers first started to when they started industrializing and dumping the pollutants in the river.
The primary polluter was General Electric, whose companies dumped millions of pounds of highly toxic PCBs into the river between 1945 and 1977.
More satisfying life at General Electric. Progress is our most important product.
Local environmental groups, such as the Riverkeepers, Scenic Hudson, and Clearwater, began to advocate for cleaner and healthier waters in the 60s with the help of folk music legend Pete Seeger.
Now, Pete Seeger was one of those figures that everybody loves, and he was able to attract people to get them involved in the environmental movement. Pete Seeger and Clearwater even sailed to Washington, D.C. to promote the passage of the Clean Water Act.
The Clean Water Act of 1972 established basic guidelines for regulating the discharge of pollutants into U.S. waterways. In 1984, the Hudson River was labeled as a Superfund site by the EPA, which forced GE to clean up their pollutants.
Now, there was this big cleanup program, which they did. Out of that 12 million, they dredged up about 350,000 pounds. Now, that's kind of a drop in the bucket.
I'm Dr. Kevin Wu. I am an associate professor at SUNY Empire State College and also the assistant director for the Center for the Study of Pinniped Ecology and Cognition. So there are five, at least.
Dr. Kevin Wu is studying the return of the gray and harbor seal population within New York City waterways, ending their over 100-year absence.
Now that we're starting to see them reliably every year, it's also another indicator that the system here is becoming healthier, right? That the quality of food is getting better, that the conditions in the ecosystem are getting better, such that it can sustain all the populations that essentially rely on each other. Fish may not be completely healthy or devoid of toxins in these waters. They must be healthy enough, one, for their populations to be stable, two, for their populations to be stable enough to attract predators, so seals, both gray and harbor seals. The boats never get close enough to spook them. Oh yeah, they all got spooked. Actually, that was interesting. They all got spooked, they're gone. People don't really know that they're here, you know, so we're working on the education aspect, right? We're working on trying to get people, one, to know that there are sort of these animals here essentially in their backyard.
Sightseeing and ecotourism play a pivotal role in raising awareness of not just seals, but all marine life in New York waters.
I run New York Media Boat. When we have tourists on the boats and we tell them that, you know, there are whales and seals and occasionally dolphins, they are very surprised and they're always looking to, you know, trying to see one. Twice we have seen a whale now in the Hudson River.
No, he's gonna get Eddie.
Oh my god.
That is a, I would say, fairly unusual event. We don't believe that they are lost. They seem to be following the food. So what we do is we actually assign one of our boats to sort of just stay with the whale at a good distance. To photo document it, but also to provide a safety zone for the animal. You know, we have a lot of ferry traffic here, and the last thing we want to see is an animal getting run over a ramp by a ship. So we just sort of keep an eye on where the whale is and notify any traffic in the area if they are on a collision course.
Off course, media boat outbound.
Boat traffic is just one of many urban threats that marine life has to contend with in New York's waters.
Plastics, trash, debris in not only our waters, but it's a worldwide problem that's affecting marine species across the board.
Yeah, actually the worst thing that we see out here are the helium balloons. We see a lot of balloons in the water. I mean, we have seen seals, like, they were like tangled up in just a string from these Mylar balloons. You know, that we don't like seeing.
Trash, sewage water, fertilizers, prescription drugs, and chemicals still plague New York's waters and the life that inhabits it.
Obviously, we are taking steps in the right direction. The biodiversity in our area, you know, increasing, and that we have all these magnificent creatures here. So we have to continue what we're doing and then, you know, take additional steps as well.
And here in the Hudson River, we need to think, what am I doing that can affect it? We need to see ourselves as intimately connected with our environment. If we don't care about the environment won't care about us, and it will have an effect.